Now, why does all this and having an education like that, why would it matter to your organization? And I got three answers for that, at least right now. One is, this is critical for everybody to know how to work. It's critical work skill to be able to do what I've been talking about, no matter where you are or who you are. We coach new hire, we do this often for onboarding, and we coach CEOs. Same material and methodology, very different content, obviously, but they're all both skills, and frankly, it's needed at all those levels. As a matter of fact, the more senior it is, oftentimes the more critical it is that they get these skills. What's interesting is it's the most senior, sophisticated people that are the hungriest for this. That surprised me years ago. I thought very senior people would have this nailed. No, they don't. You know, they're doing something that gets them to that place, but man, they are just hungry for something that'll give them a little bit more bandwidth and fine-tune, you know, what they're doing. So critical work skill, first of all. The second reason is that this is not another training for a box to check off. This is an education that will turbocharge all of your trainings and all of your competencies. Trying to do a leadership training or a presentation skills training or a supervisory training and have people walk out buried in chaos, out of control with what they're trying to do, good luck. What this does is gives you the capabilities to have them be able to then implement that stuff so you can leverage the investment you're already making in your training and development. Not only that, this keeps the trust contract intact. Because this is really about commitments. It's about, you know, making sure nothing's falling through the cracks. Somebody said they would. Are you tracked? Is that happening or not? Is your money where your mouth is? I'll unpack those a little bit. The critical work skill for everybody, why? Because the late, great Peter Drucker, you may know who he was, would tell everybody in this room, your toughest work is defining what your work is, because knowledge worker does not make your work self-evident. It shows up as a blob, and then you have to figure out what you're going to do about it. And so that skill of defining your work, most people just work. They don't realize work is an art and craft that you can actually learn how to do. That's what we figured out. What is the art and craft of work itself, no matter what the work is? And it has its own best practices and worst practices. Also, what GTD does is gives you the ability to deal with the unexpected. A lot of people go through things, they set up structures, they don't disturb my structure. No, sorry. Let go and recalibrate fast. The ability to deal with surprise is one of the most elegant skills or capabilities or practices you will be able to get your people to have. It's coming, folks, by the way. There's a surprise coming toward each one of you. You can't see. Me too. So guess what I'm not doing? As a matter of fact, as soon as I leave here today, guess what I'm going to be doing? Up in my hotel room, emptying my in basket. I've been on a roll. I got about 250, some of them pretty important up there, and I'm going to clean house as fast as I can. Why? There's a surprise coming toward me this weekend I can't see. And when that sucker hits, I won't as close to zero backlog of unprocessed, undefined work as possible, so I can be present with the new thing and make a good assessment about whether to do it or not, or how it fits into my whole game. But until I see my whole game, and in order to get my whole game whole, that's not free. I am fellow student to all this like anybody, folks. Increase responsiveness. Man, does that make a whole lot of difference here. Increased responsiveness means quicker, you get quicker back. A lot of the instant feedback, anecdotally anyway, when we work with managers and executives on this, is people are amazed how soon they get back to emails they get. Wow! A quick little example of that, I coached a guy who was tagged to be the next CEO. He'd come in from another industry. Brilliant guy. Fast. This guy could type 125 words a minute on a Mac and a PC. He was fast and very smart. He'd been head marketing for global marketing for one of the big credit card companies, and then brought into healthcare to then potentially be the CEO because they needed a marketing consciousness. So anyway, bottom line of that, I'm working with him. This guy had an average, before I started working with him, he kept an average backlog of 4,000 unprocessed emails in his email. After I worked with him, I've never seen anybody make that significant change that sticked. After I worked with him, I came back, checked in with him 12 months later, zero backlog email. It's always coming in, but he zeroed it out on a consistent basis. Guess what difference that made? The big presenting issue for him was his calendar. This guy was booked for 3 months solid, right? Nobody could, Everybody's trying to bang on the door to get on this guy's, you know, calendar, and his assistants are just turning to toast, trying to fend everybody off. Some of you know what I'm talking about. You know, with those kind of folks. As soon as his email was zeroed out, that pressure came off. Why? Why do you think they needed the meeting? Because they couldn't get a response from email. They needed his response for okay and decision-making about stuff, so they had to just show up at his door to get this guy's attention. As soon as he shortened that response time to literally within a day or two, they said, oh, okay. He was the bottleneck. So responsiveness can look like a lot of things, but that's a good example, a pretty dramatic one, but that's a good example of what I'm talking about. Once people get on top of this game and start to work it with rigor. We have used this material in a major company that did a significant survey internally. They asked their population, they said, what are the biggest issues? How do you spend most of your day? You know, what's kind of the nature of it? And it was basically emails and meetings and interruptions. Right? That's how they assessed basically what was driving their day. After working with this material, they interviewed everybody and they said, now how do you spend your day? Focused on outcomes and actions. Same organization, no less work, but they shifted how they started to engage with this material. And outcome and action thinking is what you want to build in, not reaction to just meetings and emails, and those are the biggest presenting issues, especially for your senior people, trust me. If they haven't self-assessed, they'll tell you that's what's eating into their productivity hugely. So adding outcome and action consciousness to meetings, as well as to email and communication, makes a huge difference, huge. The meta-competency, what does that mean? First of all, it's going to give people room to learn. I can't tell you how many leaders, all this leadership stuff, yeah, it's really great. I don't have room. I don't have time. Like, good luck. So people can get space to actually do the development process. Also, then they get tools to make sure that they, when they walk out of there with stuff to do, they actually get it done. So basically, this is going to give you traction for every single thing in terms of all your initiatives, as well as all your training initiatives, simply because they'll have room to actually do it, and they'll have an execution capability to actually move on them and implement that stuff. The cool thing about this methodology is it also then quickly internalizes for someone, so for the rest of their lives, they'll know how to get back in control and focus no matter what you hand to them to do. So it's a great skill to internalize, and it can be relatively easily internalized with good training. And that'll serve them the rest of their lives. Invariably, when we coach executives, they want us to go home and coach their spouses, coach their kids, coach their housekeeper, coach all their staff or whatever, because they catch how powerful this is just in terms of the environment itself. Speaking of which, in that environment, if people aren't keeping their commitments, come on, I don't care how much lip service you paid, or yes, we are going to, and trust us. It's like, no kidding. Core element of leadership is trust. A core thing will undermine trust is breaking agreements or not keeping them. So you better know what the agreements are. You better manage them, keep them, don't make them, or renegotiate them. But if you haven't kept track of what all those agreements are, can't do it. It also enhances their sustainability in the engagement. We've had so many people tell us that they were just about to walk out the door until they got GTD, and it's like then they were able to surf on top of it, and they were so delighted because they didn't want to leave. There were a lot of good things, but they couldn't stand the overwhelm and the burnout. And it's growing out there, folks. I still see it out there, not stopping. So the tools to be able to give them a better quality of work life. You know, I was... Open office is awful unless people have GTD. Once people have GTD, you walk into an open office, everything is quick and quiet. People are not interrupting each other. Why? Because everybody's highly focused. They're using systematic processes for communications. They're not going, I need. Huge, huge factors. There are now some new surveys showing how absolutely open offices are undermining productivity tremendously. You actually need a hybrid. Steelcase or clients of ours, they're building spaces, not just file cabinets now. So their spaces include both. So you can have alone, quiet, private stuff, small group space, as well as communal space, in case you like that. So there's nothing wrong with that, except if that's all you got and people don't have the capability to manage themselves appropriately, they're just going to dump their virus on everybody else. Basically, it just moves the culture up the food chain for all these reasons. Responsiveness increases. the static goes down, the noise goes way down, and you're focused on outcome and action. So there's the world we're in, folks. That ain't you and I are both walking out into that. You know, and it's, you know, whenever we walk out, mind like water, nice place to get to about all that. However, the water often does not feel like this. It often feels like this. Does for me. Still water. Now, but wouldn't it be nice if you could surf on top of that, like this guy, right? Have a nice board, surf on top. Yeah, so GTD is kind of like the surfboard where I sit on top of this wave and enjoy it. But what's going to happen to this surfer? Invariably, this surfer is going to... Yeah, and invariably, no matter how good you get at all this GTD stuff, you're going to fall off. Frankly, if you're not falling off fairly regularly, you're not playing a big enough game. But what does this surfer have? You probably can't see it from there. But there's a little ankle thing around his ankle with a little elastic thing tied to the board. That's called an ankle tether. Why do they wear an ankle tether? So I can get back on fast. And if you have an ankle tether, guess what you'll do? Surf bigger waves.